Darlington Raceway, the lady in black, too tough to tame. And the Busch guys find out just how tough she is. Pole sitter Dale Jarrett knows she's all he can handle.
I'm in the wall.
The heat is on in Phoenix as the IRL returns to the track. Davy Jones is in the driver's seat, still recovering from his crash earlier this year.
You always think, well, it'll never happen to you, but that's our livelihood. And it's kind of the risk we take.
We'll go deep in the heart of Texas to find John Force in a new car. Hey, that's funny. So straighten up and drive right. Obey the traffic rules. RPM Tonight is next. Quick camera moves on the RPM tonight. Glad to have you with us, sitting in for the ailing Kenny May, and I'm Reese Davis. Well, we've got a busy weekend coming up with the IRL in Phoenix, the Hot Rods in Houston, and a big NASCAR convention at the track they call Too Tough to Tame. Guys on the Busch Grand National Circuit caught a break last weekend in Vegas. Mark Martin's number 60 car, which had taken the trip to Victory Lane in each of the three previous races, skipped the trip to Vegas, giving the rest of the Busch group a chance. Jeff Green bolted through the open door, winning the pole and the race in his 100th career Busch start. This weekend, we're heading down to Darlington for the Diamond Hill Plywood 200. And off we go down to Darlington, South Carolina, the track they call Too Tough to Tame. Tough day for Elliott Sadler. He was a pole sitter in car 29. Passed by Jeff Burton and Dick Trickle, falls back to fifth. On lap 29, ARCA Series champion Tim Steele gets spun around by Mike McLaughlin. Well, tougher to make time in reverse. Only his second start in the Phoenix Racing Chevy. Up front, Rouse teammates battle for the lead. Martin passed by Jeff Burton. Burton lead a total of 46 laps. Here is Burton in the ninth car, putting Stevie Reeves down by a lap. Burton, the race leader, staying out of trouble. Unfortunately, Tim Bender cannot say the same. See Burton out of there, and Bender's car bumped up. Has some damage. Lap 115, caution flag out again. This time it's Mark Crowe hitting the wall in turn four. Dennis Setzer, even more trouble. He just puts himself right in the spin cycle, right down the front straightaway. Back up front, it's a race to the line. Points leader Todd Bodine stays on the lead, beating Randy LaJoy to the stripe. A big break for Bodine. Now to lap 132, a bad break for Greg Sachs and Elliott Sadler. They get together, swap a little fender, kiss a little paint. Laughlin nowhere to go. Up to the pits. Royal Oak Chevy banged up. Excuse me, sir, if you've been injured in an accident, you have a personal injury attorney. On the restart, the battle for the lead begins. Burton goes down low and makes a run at LaJoy, but LaJoy able to hold him off. That perhaps is foreshadowing. Sadler, meanwhile, would cut a tire, and, well, that one's about had it. Maybe you'll get a refund. Seventh and final caution of the day. Jeff Burton holding his grill together with his belt, it looks like. Burton in the Ford then takes aim at the lead. But again, it's LaJoy in the Chevy holding him out on the final lap. Can Randy LaJoy hang on for the win?
Burton on the inside, they head for three. They're less than a half a lap to the checkered flag. LaJoy will back off and come downstairs.
It seems Dale Earnhardt do that so many times, and it worked. Now Burton's going to try to do the same thing. But he's not been put up with LaJoy.
And there was much rejoicing. Yay. Randy LaJoy picked up his seventh career BGN win, and here is how they finished at Darlington on Saturday. LaJoy getting his second victory of the season. 74 car had to come from the 11th starting spot to win it. Burton, his best BGN finish of the season in second place. Previous BGN best this year was sixth at Richmond. Dick Trickle in their third, followed by another strong Mark Martin run, and Phil Parsons in fifth. Second five go like this. Buckshot Jones out of the University of Georgia. Fuller, Green, Tracy Leslie, and Todd Bodine. Nathan Butkey finished 20th. He said Butkey. Here's Bill Weber with your winner, Randy LaJoy.
Well, you had a great run at Daytona, but you've been missing in action for a few weeks, but welcome home.
What a way to get back home. It's, well, I'd like to dedicate this to the Nemechek family. You know, they lost a son last week with John. He was a friend of ours, friend of racing. I'd dedicate this win to him. But, you know, just when we got Mark Martin beat, he sends a teammate on us. So, I don't know, Sherry. I'm not sure what happened to my teammate.
Who taught you that crossover move here with Burton in the closing lap?
I used to watch that on Sunday. I'm on the couch. All those Winston Cup guys do that. So I figure they can do it, I can do it.
What were you thinking, Randy, when he was coming down the backstretch? Because he looked like he might be able to catch you.
I didn't. I mean, he was good. I mean, that was the only hope I had to take him in here, and hopefully he drifted up. Because he would have brake checked me, we both would have wrecked, but he didn't, and he slid up, and I got underneath him. Just a tribute to this race team and this race car and these guys on this team.
Well, congratulations. I know this means a lot to you. Pick up a lot of points.
Well, we like wins, too, so this is another one. We'll take the points, too.
Thank you, Bill, and thank you, Randy. You know, on that move, you can't teach that. It's just instinct. When it comes to D's, Randy LaJoie's gotten straight A's, winning the opener at Daytona and now at Darlington. Picked up 119 grand in those two races alone compared to 58,000 in the other four races this year. Let's hear a little more from the drivers, starting with Jeff Burton, who finished just 2/10 behind LaJoie.
I knew what Randy was going to do. I just, it's open, you know, when you go by somebody like that, that hole is open. Randy did a good job. He knew what he needed to do. I knew what he was going to do. I didn't know how to stop him.
I think it was a good race for us. You know, I'd like to have a little more grip out there, but so a lot of other guys. It seemed like we were better in long runs, you know, and we got a lot of short runs at the end there, and they didn't help us any, but, you know, I just got to be thankful. It gives us the car to go to the next race.
We're in the top five or around the top five every week, but we want to win. We weren't quite good enough to win today. We had a pretty good car, but just weren't quite good enough to win.
That's a big deal that me and Ricky have always talked about, is being patient, and that's what we did today. And, you know, we kind of just moved up gradually. We didn't move up real fast, and just being patient got us up to sixth place today.
So the Busch Grand National point standings now look like this. Bodine holds on to the points lead over Parsons, but it shrinks to 14. LaJoie remains in third, followed by last week's winner, Jeff Green. Martin, who's won three of the six races this year, is still fifth place in points. Dick Trickle moves up from eighth to sixth, followed by Buckshot, Elton Sawyer, Mark Green, and Tim Fedewa, who replaces Elliott Sadler in the 10th spot. Hickory, North Carolina, the site for next Saturday's Galaxy Foods 300. Well, in Darlington, friends of John Nemechek are doing just what he'd want them to do. They're racing, albeit with saddened hearts. Nemechek died, as you probably know, Friday from head injuries suffered in last Sunday's truck race in Homestead, Florida. 27-year-old Nemechek had been in a coma since he crashed into the wall on the 148th lap of that race. John Nemechek's brother Joe is not racing in Darlington this weekend, replaced in the 42 car by Phil Parsons.
I can't express my sympathy enough for the Nemechek family, John and his parents, and Joe and Andrea. It's when you lose somebody that's in a sport, it's like losing family.
It's a terrible thing. It's really a terrible thing. I got a lot of respect for his mother and father and John. You know, we always got along good. I tried to help him along, you know, when he was more or less a rookie like everybody else was at the time.
In honor of John Nemechek, the Winston Cup cars had decals placed on them in his memory. People also wearing buttons with his picture on them. Here's Jeff Bodine.
I went and talked to my mother a few days after, and she said, now you know what your father and I have been going through all these years with the three of you out there racing, and now with Barry, she's really worried even more. So it is a family sport, and there's a lot of concern for everyone, not just my brothers or my son. And when something happens, this community we have here really pulls together, and we're all very sorry what happened last week.
Likewise for all of us here at RPM tonight. Funeral arrangements are pending. There has been a trust fund established in John's name in Homestead, Florida. Well, Ari Leyendijk made Scottsdale, Arizona his home, and he makes himself right at home on Arizona tracks as well. Last year at the Desert Mile, Leyendijk won the pole in a record time, then won the race, his second win at Phoenix International Raceway. Leyendijk and 21 others were in Phoenix Saturday to qualify for Sunday's 53rd Phoenix race. So let's check out IRL qualifying. That looks a lot like the desert because we are indeed in Phoenix. There is Leyendijk. Qualified fourth, a speed of 165.784. He's got a proven history on the ovals. Owner-driver Eddie Cheever qualifies eighth, 163.510. He won January's Indy 200 at Walt Disney World. Surprise of the day, rookie Jim Guthrie off the Formula Atlantic, Formula Ford 2000 series. Made a jump on his second lap, 169.484. He'll start outside on the front row. 96 Indy 500 champ Buddy Lazier starts 13th. 163.543 was his qualifying speed. The man on the pole, no surprise, Tony Stewart, 170 miles per hour and change, also received an extra 10,000 for capturing two poles in a row.
Tony Stewart, your second straight pole. You blistered the field with a 170.012 miles an hour.
The car was great. You know, the last practice before qualifying, we really got the car running nice and handling nice, but we thought we could make it a little bit better. So we went back and looked at all the telemetry sheets and made it about two or three changes that really helped out. The thing was just absolutely perfect in qualifying. This track traditionally changes a lot when the temperature changes. So I think the fact that I ran the midgets and the Silver Crown cars here in the past really helped because we have to do the same thing. We have to chase the racetrack. So I think our homework in those cars helped us here.
Tony, I know this is something you don't want to be known for, but you've led the most laps. You've led the most races. When you guys, but no wins, but when you were here for testing a couple of weeks ago, you simulated a race. Do you think that's going to prepare you for the race?
Well, I don't think it's hurting us any. I think we learned a lot of information in that test that we can use. So, you know, when it comes time to go to a race, you know, we'll see what happens, and maybe we'll be on top of day.
All right, good luck. Back to you in the studio.
All right, Marlo Klein, thank you very much, and thank you, Tony. He was the fastest in Friday's opening practice and fastest during Saturday's qualifying. Guthrie joins him on row one. Defending champ Lion Dyke starting fourth. Eddie Cheever, who also an Arizona guy, born in Phoenix, he will start eighth.
The Phoenix always changes. Every time 10 degrees creeps into the track, you get a little bit of push, and it's forever changing, and it takes a lot of patience to work with the track to get what you need.
It's changing from session to session, and really it's out there, you know, kind of who can stab it, you know, where it is. But, you know, I'm sure it's going to change again for this afternoon session, and it's going to change again for tomorrow during the race.
We've been chasing the weather and the setup all, you know, ever since we got here. So every time the temperature changes, the car changes drastically.
Seven rookies in the field for Sunday's race, including Kenny Brack starting outside row five. Brack driving the Gallus Racing car formerly driven by Davey Jones. Indy 500 champ Buddy Lazier, powered by the Nissan Infiniti engine, starts outside row seven. It was in Phoenix last March that he crashed during practice, fracturing 16 vertebrae. Well, still ahead on the RPM tonight, Indy Racing League driver Davey Jones will be in the driver's seat. It's been a long road to recovery since his January crash in Orlando.
You know, it's not like that I have to relive the incident and I have any fears or anything. I don't have any fear. And I think that's going to make it easier for me to just pick up where I left off.
Also ahead, last call for happy hour, heading back down to Darlington County for that. That's coming up after the break.
RPM Tonight is being brought to you by Range Rover, the ultimate luxury vehicle from Land Rover. And by John Deere, makers of quality lawn and grounds care equipment. Nothing runs like a deer.
Top 25 qualified for the Trans-South 400 on Friday. Eric Hope, the last one there. Only four cars went back out on the track Saturday. Spencer's going to start 26th. Waltrip Michael behind him. Kyle Petty, 28th. He started 20th or worse in every race this season. John Andretti, Mike Skinner on row 17. Ward Burton will start outside row 20 on a provisional. He won the pole for this race last year, but an accident forced him to finish 38th. Next three on the grid have a combined 99 starts at Darlington. Didn't help him much in qualifying. Earnhardt, 9 wins at the track that had to use a champion's provisional. Steve Grissom back behind the wheel after a terrible crash in Atlanta, but he didn't qualify for this one.
You don't get it done on the first day, boy, I tell you, you really got your work cut out for you on the second. You know, again, like I say, we didn't get it done yesterday, and hey, everybody come in, they gave 110%, we tried, and you know, we just didn't get it done today. But you know, again, I mean, it's a race, you hate not to be in it, but still, you know, on the other hand, hey, we got Texas coming up. We had a good test out there, and we look forward to getting back out there.
So off to happy hour in Darlington. Pole sitter Dale Jarrett passing Martin Martin on the inside. A speed today for Jarrett of 163.696. Bobby Labonte, meanwhile, needing a gear change in the garage and getting some work on that interstate ride. Jeff Gordon calling the car he's using Blacker, the lady in black. Track today, 164.281, second best of the day. You're on board with Martin Martin. He's behind Ricky Craven. Martin's speed, 164 and change. That was third best of the day. Earnhardt on the track. He had to take that provisional. As I mentioned, his speed under 160 miles per hour. Craven, the best speed of happy hour, 164.474. He was followed by his teammate Gordon. Ford had the next five fastest speeds with Martin Martin heading that list. And pole sitter Dale Jarrett, the seventh fastest happy hour speed. Well, John Ford won 13 events in 96 behind the wheel of his Pontiac. This is a new year, and John has a new car. That's coming up next. Well, the force has not been with John lately. John Force, six-time funny car champ and 1996 Driver of the Year, says hello, Houston, with a new car and a losing streak. As Todd Wright reports, Force, knocked out in the second round at the Gator Nationals 2 weeks ago, can now say yes if anyone asks, have you driven a Ford lately?
There's a little bit difference, but Tony's cars has run 300, just like the Pontiac, and he's running the Fords with it. So it's going to be fine. I think we're going to get some wind tunnel time to make some improvements. But I'm excited to make the switch.
We got the magic right now. Our old hot rod just talks every time it starts.
But will the switch drastically affect Force's performance? He won the 94 Funny Car title with an Oldsmobile, then switched to Pontiac for his 95 and 96 titles. As for Ford, it has never won a Funny Car Series title since the point system started in 1975. Just three Mustangs are pre-entered this weekend. Force and teammate Tony Pedregon, along with Whit Bazemore. Al Hoffman trails Force by 45 points. Hoffman made the trip to Houston, but still cannot race. He's recovering from a broken right arm and injured left hand, suffered while actually winning the Gator Nationals 2 weeks ago.
I'm feeling fine. We're going to try to race here, but I'm going to give it another week. I'm still a little bit sore. I could get in the car right now, but take a chance on putting me out for a couple of races. I don't want to do that.
Kenny Bernstein is the only Top Fuel driver to win the Slick 50 Nationals twice, 1991 and last year. And remember, since 1992, at least one national record's been set at this event every year.
All right, Todd, thanks a lot. Here are your top qualifiers for the NHRA Slick 50 Nationals in Houston. Amato Top and Top Fuel, Cruz Pedregon, strong run in the funny car division. All of these drivers set track records for elapsed time. Final round coverage of the Slick 50 Nationals on the Deuce, 5 p.m. Eastern, Sunday night. Hey, if you're going to the event, turn left at FM 565 and drive 2.5 miles to the track. By the way, if you see where the old barn used to be, you've gone too far. Coming up next, in the driver's seat with Davey Jones, just 2 months removed from a near-fatal crash, and he's ready to race again. But first, our RPM tonight question. We want to know, with the IRL in Phoenix, we ask, who's the last person to win the spring race at the Desert Mile and the Indy 500 in the same year? RPM tonight question, who was the last person to win the IndyCar spring race in Phoenix and the Indy 500 the same year? The answer? Al Unser Sr. turned the trick in 1971. The four-time Indy 500 champ, one of only four people to complete the Desert Rickyard Double. January 23rd, 1997 will be a day Davey Jones wishes he could forget or erase, but he never will. That's the day the IRL driver crashed while practicing for the Indy 200 at Disney World. Suffered serious head and neck injuries and spent the next month and a half in hospitals. Jones and all race car drivers know danger is just a part of racing. It's a way of life. Al Marlo Klain sat down with Davey and his wife Mary Elizabeth Jones at their home in Lake Tahoe, Nevada.
We all know as race drivers that it could happen to us, and we always think, well, it'll never happen to you, but that's our livelihood. And it's kind of the risk we take. You get to a comfort level to where it's like going to your office. You know, you're real familiar with the situation and you're pretty well in control on it. And, you know, my worst injuries prior to this was being hit by a car walking across the street. So, you know, you never really know. I mean, it could happen to a football player or, you know, a hockey player or even a race driver. So, you know, it's the nature of the beast, I guess. If you go back to the day of the incident, I remember all the things that went on the morning of and getting strapped into the car. So, you know, if I look back on it, you know, all I remember is really positive things. And I feel now like I've just been out of race car for a couple months.
It didn't look good for him after the accident. Now look, it's amazing.
It is amazing, and I'm extremely fortunate. And I think I realized that probably in the emergency room when they let me go in and see him. And Davey gave a thumbs up. So I kind of felt then, I guess that was my security of knowing, all right, he is thinking, he is going to be fine. Or in my eyes, he is going to be fine.
I think if this whole incident has really affected anybody, it's really affected the people that are close to me, like the people on the race team and friends and family. You know, they're the ones that had to go through it day by day. And for me, it's just, you know, you just got to go through with what comes towards you. You know, it's like you don't really have any choice. You just got to go, you know, day by day.
What's the next step in the rehabilitation process for you?
Basically, I have to wear this halo for another month, you know, so if everything goes to plan, it'll be off the beginning of May. The left side of my body was affected a little bit more by nerve damage, so obviously walking around and just everyday movement built up my legs quite quick, and the rest of my muscles except my shoulder. So that's really what we're doing here, is we're trying to tape the muscles or the ligaments back up where they kind of fallen down. And then within time, as we work on rebuilding the muscle, it'll just all come back up into place.
What do you think your realistic goals are for a comeback in racing?
I thought, you know, well, hey, it would be nice to make the Indy 500, you know, the biggest race of the year. You wouldn't want to miss it. But if everything went a little bit ahead of schedule and to plan, it would really be pushing it. So, you know, my plan is to be there and to participate one way or another with Gallus Racing. And, you know, shortly after the month of May, get back to testing and do a race shortly after.
After the crash, some other drivers were concerned about the safety of the IRL cars. One driver even said that someone dropped the ball on the safety. Do you agree with that?
Well, I think, you know, that any time that there's an incident, you know, you're always investigating it, you know, not only in racing, but in every kind of accident. And, you know, safety is always a big concern, and you're always learning from it. And, you know, whether, you know, something went wrong or something's not right, at least I know that the next time I get in the car, they might be a little bit more cautious of whatever it may be.
After going through this, do you have any reservations about him getting back into a car?
No, I don't, not at all. He said, you know, I've never asked you, but what do you think? And I said, well, you know, I think it'd be awful if you didn't go back and do what you love doing the most. And, I mean, I married a race car driver with full understanding of what he does, and I never want to change that, make him unhappy.
You got to make the most of it, you know. I mean, I could get really down and you know, but I don't have a choice, you know. I mean, and if you keep positive and upbeat, you know, everything will go by a little bit quicker.
What we're looking forward to the most is David getting back on the racetrack. I mean, obviously he's chomping at the bit and going to be pretty excited when getting back in the car. He might calm down a little more.
It's not like that I have to relive the incident and I have any fears or anything. I don't have any fear. And I think that's going to make it easier for me to just pick up where I left off.
Madeline, what's Daddy?
Number one.
Sure, number one.
I'll bet you that she's number one with Dad, too. The Indy 500 comes up on May 25th of this year. Davey, of course, finished second in that race a year ago. Be great to at least see him make an appearance at the track for that one. Well, join us on Sunday for an RPM day-night double dip. All the festivities start at noon Eastern, RPM today, then 8 p.m. Eastern on RPM tonight. More highlights than a Beverly Hills hairdresser coming on that one.